is our fourth session and the last session of chapter number 8. Okay, so let us start with our today's session. Here I am sharing my screen with you all. Yes, so the fourth session and chapter number 8, that is cell biology and biotechnology, and today we are going to focus more on the stages in the agriculture. Before we start, we need to recall 2 to 3 concepts, like that is the same as we are doing it in 3 sessions, like biotechnology, then what is revolution, then we have agriculture and biotechnology. How it's related to each other. First, we'll see the definition of biotechnology. Biotechnology is a technology which is based on the biology, which is especially used in agriculture, food science, and medicine. United Nations Conventions on Biological Diversity defines biotechnology as any technological applications that uses biological systems, living organisms, or derivatives thereof to make or modify the products or the processes for specific use. Biotechnology is often used to refer to genetic engineering technology of the 21st century. So it is what? This is genetic engineering technology of the 21st century. That is what we called as a biotechnology. Then we'll see the biotechnology revolution. What it is? So why are we talking about a biotechnology revolution? Why are you in this class and why we are discussing? Okay, what's so new in it? Our knowledge of a cell and molecular biology has reached a point where we can manipulate organisms at the molecular level. Okay, we are doing the manipulations at the molecular level. This is very important. This is what we are doing in biotechnology. Agriculture and biotechnology, how they are related to each other. Agriculture biotechnology includes a range of tools that scientists employ to understand and manipulate the genetic makeup of the organisms for use in the production or processing of the agricultural products. Okay, the processing as well as the production as well as genetic makeup of the organisms. This is what is required in the field of agriculture and the applications of biotechnology. So that is today's concern, important stages in the agricultural development, and it is the last part of our chapter. Here we are going to see this in a 3 ways. First one is a green revolution, second one will be white revolution and blue revolution. Let us see each one of them. First we'll go for green revolution. Problems, what is the background, why this green revolution happened? Okay. Problems of the population explosion were started to appear at the beginning of the 20th century. Almost all the countries, especially underdeveloped and developing countries, had been badly affected by the effects of the poor quality as well as the quantity of the food. Various methods applied for the harvesting maximum yield from the minimum land are collectively called as a green revolution. So these 2-3 lines, these last 2-3 lines are very important. What we say is the maximum yield from the minimum land, and that is what the green revolution. Let's see about its concept. The green revolution in India refers to a period when the Indian agriculture was converted into industrial system due to the adoption of the modern methods. Now we have to understand what are these modern methods and technologies, such as the use of high yielding variety, we also call this as a HYV seeds. Then tractors, irrigation facilities, pesticides and fertilizers. So we have introduced these things in our traditional, instead of traditional agricultural methods, and then we have got it the maximum yield from the minimum land. Now we'll see scientists, those who have involved in this green revolution, their contribution. Improvised dwarf varieties of the wheat and rice. Okay, then proper use of fertilizers and pesticides and water management has led to the increased production of the food grains, and thereby the large population had been saved from the hunger. Dr. Norman Borland from USA and Dr. M.S. Swaminathan from India have valuable contribution in this green revolution. So these are the two scientists that we have their names in our textbook also. Here we have one more, that is Elvin C. Stackman. So these people, and there are many more, those who have given their contribution in this field of green revolution. Here you can see the uses, the tools of this green revolution, the pesticides and irrigation. Then you can see the tractor and high yielding variety seeds. What was the impact of this green revolution on India? The green revolution spreading over the period from the 1967-68 to 1977-78 changed the India status from the food deficient country to one of the world's leading agriculture nations. Until 1967, the government largely concentrated on expanding the farming areas. Our main concern after the independence was the getting self-sufficient in terms of food and its security. Various research institutes and laboratories are engaged in development of these new varieties of various crops through the research. So here you can see the many of the institutes in India. For example, the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, which is also called as an IARI, which is at New Delhi. The National Citrus Research Institute, which is at Nagpur. The citrus words itself tell you from the oranges, citrus. Okay. Then we have and allied branches, the Indian Institute of Science, that is as well as we have National Pomegranate Research Institute, which is at Solapur. We'll see the species of the rice in India. Now, okay, which are the different species? The scientists in India, West Bengal, have discovered the three new varieties of the rice. Which are they? Let us see. Which will ensure the further increase in paddy production in the state. The new varieties, Bhupesh, Rajdeep and Dhruba, that will be cultivated across the state, and the production has already started in some of the places. Then Institute of Biotechnology at state level, especially in Maharashtra, state of Maharashtra, it is ICAR, which is National Institute of Abiotic Stress Management, which is at Malegaon, Maharashtra. Abiotic Stress Management, okay? Then, that was about the green revolution. Now, our next concern, and the next stage in this, the important stage in the agriculture is white revolution. White revolution itself tells you it is about the milk. Okay, here you can see this milkman. What was the need? Why do we require this white revolution in our country? As green revolution, it was required for this food security of the nation, right? So like that, white revolution, let us see what it has done for us. The white revolution helped increase the milk productivity, and the milk was now sold at a competitive market prices. This program increased the demand for the development and production of the healthy animals for the maximum production and circulation of this milk. We required healthy animals, right? So that has developed. Then use of modern technology in the milk production sector. As we are getting a lot of the production, that means the yielding of the milk, then we have modern technology. We should have modern technology so we can go for this production. And networking between the various small and the large scale dairy industries. As we are going to connect with the many of these milkmen, farmers. So there is an interlink between the large as well as the small interest in the small scale dairy industries. That was the need. Let us see the background, how it came arise. Various parts of India were rich in milk and milk products. However, those products were not sufficient to meet the needs of far-flung regions. Dr. Varghese Kurien, please remember this name. Dr. Varghese Kurien proved through the cooperative movement and use of biotechnology that dairy cannot be allied, but it will be a mainstream business. He put the cooperative dairy movement of Anand, which is at Gujarat, at all time high status. Here I would like to tell you what is cooperative. That is farm, business or any other organization which is owned and run jointly by its members who share the profit and benefits. Okay, not only one person, those who are contributing to grow this business, all of them are getting benefits from the profit that comes under cooperative. Who introduced? So we will see about this Varghese Kutia.
Teacher?
Yes, ma'am.
Teacher, sorry to disturb you, but mujhe shayad galti se host bana diya hai ma'am ne.
Okay. Let it be. You keep yourself mute.
Okay.
So here, Varghese Kurien, India, was a social entrepreneur whose billion liter idea, Operation Flood, okay, these are the two ideas, these two projects he put forward, it made dairy farming India's largest self-sustaining industry and the largest rural employment sector, providing a third of all rural income. It made India the world's largest milk producer. Okay, in Green Revolution, we are the most leading country or a nation in farming, right? Like that, just because of these projects, we have become the world's largest milk producers. Doubled the milk available for each person and increased the milk output fourfold in 30 years. So this was the contribution by this milkman of India, that is Varghese Kurien. Here you can see one ad, okay, which is given by Dr. Varghese Kurien, that is, thank you for giving us the Hosla, Pragati and Anand. Why? Because as it was settled at the cooperative level, so that's why everyone, all stakeholders got the benefits and the profit as well as the employment and prosperity. So from this slogan, we can understand what is the contribution of this white revolution in for our country. Here you can see. Mr. Varghese Kurien, he is a father of white revolution or milkman of India. Here he has established the Amul, which we know the test of India. Next, what was the impact? The white revolution in India was successful in transforming the country from a milk deficient nation to a world leader in milk production. It helped dairy farming become India's largest self-sustaining industry and also India's largest rural employment provider. Okay, the largest employment provider. This is very much important. This is the main concern of our country, that everyone should get the employment. And here, white revolution has given it's a big contribution. So that is the big impact for our nation. We'll see the self-efficacy in dairy business. While achieving the self-sufficiency in dairy business, various experiments were performed for the quality control, newer dairy products and their preservation. Why people from all over the world are gaining preference to the local white varieties? Why? Because see, as we are proceeding, as we are developing this business, then other things like biotechnology part, like, you know, research, then its production, its processing, its storage, then distribution and all these things comes under. Okay, there we need a proper technology. And here, these are the advanced stages in this industry. Okay, we'll see with the help of flowchart. A, you can see the feed production. B is the raw milk production. Then the raw milk transportation. Dairy processing is done. Then packaging, distribution, the retail consumption and at disposal. That is, we are now consuming it at our disposal, right? Then we have, here you can see at industry, how in this picture, yeah, as I have explained you through the flow chart, the same way you can observe over here with this help of this picture. And at the other picture, that is at the right side, you can see it is so highly modified and high-tech processes are taken place in the industry. So this is what the milk production at industry level. Okay, now next is our green revolution. Okay, what we have, is a blue revolution. A concept. The blue revolution refers to the time of intense growth in the worldwide agriculture industry. from the mid-1960s to present. The aquaculture industry has been growing at an average rate of 9% a year. Worldwide aquaculture production has now reached 50 million tons, up from 2 million in 1950. A similar growth in land-based agriculture, which is observed in 1960s to 1970s, in commonly referred to as the Green Revolution. So this is what the similar time period where the Blue Revolution was also introduced, and Blue Revolution is talks about the aquaculture industry. Okay, it talks about the freshwater and marine water fishes. What was the need? Okay, we have talked about Green Revolution, White Revolution. Now, why Blue Revolution also required? Production of the various useful aquatic organisms with the help of water is called as a Blue Revolution. How will we define? Production of various useful aquatic organisms with the help of water is called as a Blue Revolution. Farm ponds and the fishes are very common in East Asian countries. However, people are not only thinking of cultivating the fishes and the shrimps, but other aquatic plants and animals too. Okay, fishes as well as other aquatic plants and animals. Okay, Government of India has vowed to increase the production by encouraging the people for pisciculture. We'll see what it is. Okay, by launching the program of a Neela Kranti Mission 2016, it is also called as a NKM16, which is 50% to 100% subsidies are offered in this case. Okay, the subsidies which is provided by the government. Okay, we'll see what it is. Neela Kranti Mission 2016, it is also called as a Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. Vision. What was the vision of this project? Creating and enabling the environment for integrated development of the full potential of fisheries of the country. This is first full potential, like how we have in agriculture, like that full potential of the fisheries in our country, of the country, then along with substantially improvement in the income status of the fishers and fish farmers, keeping in view the sustainability, biosecurity and environmental concern. Okay. Like farming, here also we are thinking about the sustainability, then prosperity, income, as well as the environmental concern. What were the objectives? To fully tap the total fish potential of the country, both in the inland and the marine sector, of the triple production by 2020. To transform the fisheries sector as a modern industry, with special focus on a new technologies and processes. To double the income of the fishers and fish farmers with a special focus on increasing the productivity and better marketing post-harvest infrastructure, including the e-commerce and other technology and global best innovations. Okay, then because after fishing, it is very, very important to sell that. Okay, for that we required e-commerce, then various different technology for its storage and its transportation. So that is the main concern, right? To ensure the inclusive participation of the fishers and fish farmers in the income enhancement. Okay, like what we have from the White Revolution, like that here, their inclusive and active participation is important. Then to triple the export earning by 2020 with focus on benefits flow to the fishers and fish farmers. So including through these institutional mechanisms, in cooperative, again here also cooperative plays a major role, producer companies and other structures. So to enhance the food and nutritional security of the country, even through this Blue Revolution. Okay, so first we have seen agriculture. Second, we have talked about the White Revolution, that is about the milk and its other products. Now, third, we are talking about the fishes and fisheries. See, here you can see some of the examples of the freshwater fishes. Okay. Katla, Rohu, Mrigal. These are some of the examples. Again, you can see some of the examples of the marine water fishes. Salmon, tuna, trout, mackerel, herring, sardines, and anchovy. Okay, these are some of the examples. You can get many more. So I have mentioned few. Here you can see the shrimp and lobster. Okay. We'll see about what is pisciculture. As I told you, we are going to see in detail the breeding, rearing, and transplantation of the fish by artificial means. Okay. First, we have talked about the fisheries. Okay. We have talked about the fishery, fishing. Okay. We have talked about the cooperative level of organization of it, as well as we have talked about the Neela Kranti mission. Prosperity, its contribution to the prosperity of the fishers and the fish farming, fish farmers, right? So, like that, here we are talking about the breeding, rearing in artificial means. Okay, so in other words, we can say the fish farming. Okay, so it is a principal form of aquaculture, while other methods may follow under the mariculture. It involves raising the fish commercially in tanks or enclosures, usually for the food. So that was about the pisciculture. Our next subtopic is a fertilizers. Fertilizer or is a material of a natural or synthetic origin. It may be natural or it may be a chemical base, that is synthetic, that is applied to the soil or to the plant tissues to supply one or more plant nutrients essential to the growth of the plants. Many sources of the fertilizers exist both in natural and industrially produced. Industrial produce, that means totally synthetic, artificial. Okay. Upper layer of the soil essential in agriculture is formed due to the humus formation. Various essential elements like nitrogen, potash, then we have phosphorus that can be available to the crops due to the earthworm and fungi. In soilless farming, that is the hydroponics, then liquid chemical fertilizers are used. However, there are more harmful effects of the liberal use of chemical fertilizers, and it includes decrease in the fertility of the soil. So we need to choose wisely the fertilizers. Okay, here the word is given, that is humus. What do you mean by the humus? The organic components of the soil, the organic component of the soil formed by the decomposition of the leaves and other plant material by the soil microorganisms. Whatever the material is present over there, the natural material, the microorganisms in soil itself decomposes that, and whatever the material, the product that we get, output what we get, that is called as a humus over here. Okay. Then here you can see some of the examples how these micronutrients, or we can say fertilizers, helps the plant to grow at each stage, as well as their requirements at the stages. The first one is a germination phase. Second one is a vegetative, reproductive, and then we have the senescent phase, that is plant maturity. Okay, and then some of these micronutrients have been mentioned at the bottom. And at the left side, you can see the fertilizers and insecticides. The names are mentioned, DDT powder and urea. We'll see what are the insecticides and pesticides. Though the natural immunity of a plant can prevent the infections, use of insecticides is not under control. Irrespective of the natural friends of farmer like frogs and insectivorous birds, pesticides are used on a large scale for increase in yield. Pesticides are in fact a type of poison. This poison enters the food web. We have seen about the food web, food chain in our last standard, as well as the previous standard, that is in standard 9, right? So through the water, food and its biomagnification occurs. So various pesticides like DDT, malathion, then chloropyrifos, etc. have been proved to be dangerous. Okay. So just to overcome this problem, we have organic farming that we will see in the next slide. First, we'll see the classification of these insecticides. How do we classify its use, or how it is made up of? Okay, there are some bases. Okay, first one is based on the chemical composition. Second is based on the mode of entry of the insecticides into the body of that insect. Third, we talk about the based on the mode of action, how that insecticides will act. Fourth one is a based on toxicity, how it is toxic, how it is poisonous, okay, at what level it will kill those pests, will it be harmful to the crop. All these things will be discussed under this kind of classification. Then the fifth one is a based on the stages specificity, at what stage you should apply, should use these insecticides, as I told you the various stages of the plant growth in our previous slide. As I told you, to overcome these problems of the chemically based fertilizers or the insecticides, we need to go for a organic farming. We need to go for a sustainable option, or we can say the method and the ways. So that is one of the way is organic farming. Nowadays, organic farming and organic products are being available, and demand for them is ever increasing. Chemical fertilizers and pesticides have been used on a large scale. We have seen in Green Revolution, there was a tools like pesticides, then we have different fertilizers, okay, many things, and we have used them at a very large scale. So that was one of the disadvantages of it. Okay, so for that we have a organic farm. These poisonous chemicals reach the human body through the food and the water, and their adverse harmful effects on human and environment became apparent. Various problems like soil fertility and the pest infestation have become serious. So as to overcome these problems, the farmers have opting for organic farming. It includes the complete ban on chemical fertilizers and pesticides and use of local sturdy varieties, and thereby maintaining the natural balance. Definitely, this is a welcome decision. So therefore that, for maintaining the soil fertility, its quality, as well as to just to get rid of this pest infestation. Okay, so these are the few things which this organic farming helps us to overcome. We'll see the difference between these two. What is conventional and organic? It is based on the economical orientation. Okay, that we are talking about just a profit and not much about the environment in our conventional method. Okay, of using all those fertilizers and pesticides. Whereas organic farming talk about the ecological orientation. It gives more importance to the environment. Then GMOs are used. What do you mean by GMOs? The GMOs means the genetically modified organisms. Okay, genetically engineered things are introduced in this. Okay, then here GMOs are not used. Synthetic fertilizers are used, whereas in organic, synthetic fertilizers are not used. Weeds are controlled through the herbicides. Again, there is a use of chemicals to remove out those weeds. Whereas manually weeds are removed here in organic farming. Pesticides and fungicides are used to control the pest and disease. Here, the pest and diseases are controlled biologically, some or the other way, by means of using only natural ingredients. Okay, then produced, obtained will have chemical residues accumulated in it because we are using chemical fertilizers, insecticides. So definitely the product will also have the chemicals. Whereas the produce is free from all the chemical residues in it because we are not utilizing any of the chemical based pesticides or fertilizers. Here, air, water and soil pollution is common. Definitely it is going to pollute the environment. Here no such problem is observed. Then produce is carcinogenic and causes the several health problems. Carcinogenic, that means develops the cancer. Such elements have been found in these products, where here no such problems are observed. Then we have low input, like output ratio with the pollution. Here we have output ratio with this, with no pollution. Okay, we are getting here. In conventional also, we are getting the products, but at that cost, we are polluting the environment. Okay, then soil fertility is maintained for a shorter period. It won't be sustainable, right? But here, the soil fertility is maintained on a long-term basis because we are utilizing everything natural. Then we have intensive irrigation is required. Much of water is required in these methods. whereas irrigation requirements are reduced and optimized, okay, in organic farming. Some of the components of the organic farming, let us see what are those components. We have vermicompost, then we have green leaf manures, then we have the crop rotation, then biological management, animal husbandry. We are using the fertilizers, but they are biofertilizers and manures. Okay, so what is green leaf manures? Okay, the green leaf manure, that means, are organic manures made from the leaves which are collected from available resources and used to supply the essential plant nutrients to the soil and increase the soil fertility in a healthy manner. Means here the main source is all possible leaves which are available to us, and we are making it very much nutrient for the health of the soil. We'll see now the next subtopic, that is apiculture. You must have seen the beehive. That is the worst method of harvesting, collecting the honey from these hives is driving away the bees by smoking the hive with the burning torch and then cutting the hive into pieces. This method, this traditional method, causes the destruction of the hive on a large scale, the death of bees. And however, it is easy to collect the honey without destroying the hive and bees if artificial bee box is used. So that is what we use in this method. Okay, let's see beekeeping. For beekeeping, we have National Bee Board, that is also called as a NBB. The main aim of this NBB is a complete development of the beekeeping by promoting the scientific beekeeping in India to increase the productivity of the crops through the pollination and increase the honey production to increase the income of the beekeepers or honey farmers. Again, it is helping for the employment generation, right? Again, it is natural process. It is not harming the hive as well as the bees. One more thing is it is put forwarded by the NBB. It is this productivity of the crops through the pollination. Okay, these methods we have already learned what is the pollination and all. Okay, so then we have the next topic, that is a cultivation of the medicinal plant. Nature and Ayurveda. Okay, the cultivation of medicinal plants in India. Like, India has been gifted with a great biodiversity. Indian citizens have established the humble and strong relation with the nature. For that, we have a great tradition of Ayurveda, and that cures the disease with the help of natural resources. That is what the contribution of these medicinal plants. Importance of these medicinal plants in the primary healthcare. World perspective. According to the World Health Organization, a vast majority of people, about 80% in this developing country, relies on the herbal medicines for their primary healthcare needs. 80% of the population. So that's why there are 89 plant-derived drugs. Okay, plant-derived drugs, which is taken from the sources from the plants. Okay, the drugs have been developed, are prescribed in the industrialized world. I mean, at industry level also, we can produce such kind of medicines by using the herbs. Examples you can see here, Brahmi, then neem, turmeric, and many other, ashwagandha, ginseng, etc. We'll see the last part of our chapter, that is fruit processing. Fruits in our daily life. How? We are daily using various products which are prepared from the fruit. All are consuming the products like chocolates, juices, jams, and jellies. All these products can be produced by processing on fruits. Fruits are perishable agro produce, right? They can get spoiled, perishable. So how we are going to preserve them? It needs the processing. Okay, it needs a processing in such a way that it can be used throughout the year. The fruit processing includes various methods which are ranging from the storage in cold storage to drying, then salting, airtight packing, then preparing the murabba and evaporating, etc. These are some of the methods. Here I have given one example how the processing of the mango jam occurs. Okay, processing of the mango jam. First, we reset. Okay, that is the reception. Then washing, sorting, peeling, then cutting. Okay, whatever pulp we get, we cooked. That is in step one. Again in step two. Then bottling while hot. Then closing it. Then pasteurization. Again cooling it, washing it, labeling. Okay, making it for a cell. And then storage. And again, it is transported and distributed. Okay. So first, what do you mean by a pasteurization? It is a process in which the packaged and non-packaged food, such as a milk or any other fruit juices, are treated with a mild heat, usually to less than 100 degrees Celsius, to eliminate the pathogens and extended its shelf life. As we know, the jams we can keep for year for that particular period is mentioned on the bottle. So why? Because it's because of this pasteurization is one of the step in this processing that gives it a long shelf life. Okay, even though the fruits are perishable. So this is all about it, and here we ends up with the chapter number 8. These are my few of the questions. Here, ma'am, those who will raise their hand, please unmute them. So my first question is, give any two components of green revolution. Please raise your hands. What we have used in green revolution? That is my first question. Please raise your hands. Yes, ma'am. Am I audible?
Hello.
Ma'am? Yes. Yes.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
You are going to ask the question.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes. I have put up the questions on the screen. So okay. My first question is, give any two components of a green revolution. So students can raise their hand.
Hello, any students wants to give the answer, please raise the hand so that I can unmute the students. Hello.
Hello. Yes, Sahiba Dharavi TC. Sahiba Dharavi TC.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, give an answer, beta. What we have in Green Revolution? What we use for the maximum production?
High yielding varieties of seeds.
Very good. And one more example?
Irrigation, surface and ground.
Okay, very nice. Okay, thank you. Now you can mute yourself. Second question is, who is a milkman of India? Please name that person. Who is the milkman of India?
Miss, can I?
Yes.
The milkman of India is Varghese Kurien.
Varghese Kurien. Very good. Third one, what is Blue Revolution? You can tell me in your own words. What comes in Blue Revolution?
Yes, okay. Yes, ma'am. Now you can give the answer. With the help of water, the production of various useful aquatic organism is produced.
Yes.
This very is good. Blue Revolution.
Yes, exact. It's a correct answer. Very good. Now we have the fourth and the last question. That it give two benefits of organic farming. We have seen that chart between the conventional and organic farming. So you have to just give me the benefits of this or the uses or the advantage of this organic farming. Any two.
Ma'am, can I say?
Can I?
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Fever, pesticides, reduce soil erosion, decreases nitrate leaching into groundwater and surface water.
Yes, because the irrigation is limited in this organic farming. Yes, very good. You can give more benefits also.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Means produces free from chemical residues.
Yes, it is one of the best part of this organic farming. You know that we are excluding the all chemical based fertilizers and insecticides. Very good, students. Have any doubt? Yeah. Please go ahead. Who is that?
It is also based on ecological orientation.
Yes, because we are thinking about the environment first. okay, rather than in conventional methods, we are talking about just a prosperity, the money, okay, in terms of money, economically we are talking about. But here we are giving much importance to the environment, the ecological factors.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, when yes. are you conducting science test, online test?
Online test?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, students.
Who's this?
Hello. Who is talking there first? Hello. Online test?
Yes, ma'am.
Online test will be conducted by a school teachers, not these live lectures. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
Okay, ma'am. So if any other student have doubts, they can ask. I have done with my section.
Sakshi Verma, Tigat Nagar. Hello.
Hello, Sakshi Verma, you have any doubt? Sakshi Verma, unmute yourself. I think no one has a doubt. Okay, so we will
invite the
lecture. Thank you, Rishali ma'am. Very nice explanation.
Thank you, Anjali. Thank you, students, and happy studying.